Good evening, California FFA. My name is McKenna Kane.
I'm Amber McClellan.
And I'm Shauna Griffiths.
Now, being a state officer, you are always in the limelight, always at the center of attention. When I attended my first state conference, I can just remember all the loud music, the lights, and the lasers. It made me feel like I was at a rock show. And at the center of it, the state officers.
However, these six individuals are much different than any celebrity I know of. While they seem like stars, state officers are some of the most humble, caring, and passionate individuals I have ever met. State officers proudly represent the agriculture industry and do so with a servant heart.
I couldn't think of anyone better to fulfill this role than Ellen, better known in my family as Baby Ellen. As I'm sure you, California FFA, have gotten to know Ellen over the past year, you have learned that not only does she possess these amazing qualities, but she is also a down-to-earth girl that many can relate to. That is, if you also have a tendency to fall asleep in strange places or perpetually tardy for first period. Throughout high school, no matter the event or activity we were doing, Ellen was always the first one to fall asleep. Like the time we were driving to Red Bluff for ALA, MFE, and she was passed out in her own lap within minutes of hitting the road, only to wake up the moment we pulled in Logan Steakhouse. Or how about the time she fell asleep in a wheelbarrow during county fair while hanging out in the sheep barn? Then there are all the times that during McKenna's and my senior year, Ellen would show up to 10 minutes late after Ag Communications had started with Miss Raleigh, and Ellen would have her Bubba's Bagel in hand. After the first week or so of this, Miss Raleigh finally just accepted that Ellen was pretty much always going to be late.
While looking at the person that she is now, it's hard to remember the same tiny freshman that I first met. I can always count on Ellen to have an open ear when I need to vent, or always be ready to go on a spontaneous adventure. However, when I think of Ellen, the first word that comes to mind is determined. I always reflect back to the time when I had a sleepover at my house. At this sleepover, me and a few others thought it would be a great idea to send Ellen out on a solo snipe hunt. After a bit, Ellen returns to my house with a turkey in a brown paper bag because she was determined to not come back empty-handed. It is this determination that she has carried with her throughout high school and while serving as your state FFA reporter.
Ellen has never been afraid of having fun, while getting the job done, of course. I distinctly remember we decided to bake a carrot cake for a couple of our friends from scratch. While we did end up with a delicious homemade cake and frosting, it wasn't until half of it was on her mother's floor and our faces. And Amber, I don't know if you remember our Ag Communications news segment. We spent all day filming this assignment, complete with news, weather, an advertisement, and yes, bloopers. She came up with some pretty ridiculous ideas, like a tornado in Northern California. Or what about that time we were all stargazing in Shauna's backyard and we witnessed an intergalactic battle? The point is, Ellen has never been afraid to be herself and make any situation uniquely fun. California FFA, I'm sure you've come to know Ellen in this same way.
Here, with that same down-earth personality,
determination,
and fun-loving spirit, giving her retiring address entitled Never Fear,
your 2014-2015 state FFA reporter,
and our best friend, Ellen Van Noy.
Well, pick me up with golden hand. On the sail, on the tail you run.
According to most people, our number one fear is public speaking, and our number two fear is death. Death is number two? Does that sound right? This means that right now, I would rather you were here for my funeral than for my retiring address. Do you see how silly that sounds?
You know, there was a time when I was little when I was fearless. I had a blue Viking helmet with horns, just like the one in the slideshow, and a plastic sword. And I can still remember the day I took that sword and I fearlessly destroyed my mother's flower garden with one swoop of my blade. I can also remember learning that day that while plants may fear me, my mother did not. But don't we all have those memories as children? Those memories of feeling utterly powerful, fearless, limitless? The first time you rode a bike, I mean really rode a bike. No training wheels, no parent running alongside you, just you and the bike and the wind. Do you remember that? Do you remember what it was like? I do. We had a park about a block away from our house, and it had a huge metal slide, and it took me weeks to gather the courage to climb those nearly vertical steps, holding on to the thin metal railings as I finally came to the top. It felt like I was three stories up. And as I looked out across the road to the ocean, I felt taller than the trees. When we're little, it's not that we never feel fear. It's that, if you think about it, all of our fears have to do with gaining a new skill or learning to do something. And can you remember how your fears just disappeared, unremembered and unimportant, in that exhilarating moment when you accomplished that thing? Those fears of crashing your bike or falling from the slide, those are all number two fears. Death, injury, little things like that. But as soon as we accomplished that, they were gone, vanished, just like that. Because competency creates confidence. But then the challenges in our lives changed, didn't they? And the fears that really took hold were all number one fears. Psychologists have studied and stated that the number two fear is death, and our number one fear is public speaking. I think that they actually represent two separate categories of fear. What these categories really encompass are, number two, all fears of physical injury. Pretty legit, actually, but easy enough to conquer. And number one, all fears of social injury. Fears of not getting hurt physically, but of getting hurt emotionally. What will people think? Am I good enough? What will I look foolish? What will failure feel like? These are the fears, the number one fears that really impact our lives. Because these are the fears that too often determine what we do, what we achieve, and what we become. In elementary school, there were so many things that I absolutely loved doing. Whether it was going to softball practices after school, playing tag on the playground at recess, and even things like speech contests and school musicals. I was completely content with life with not a care in the world. However, when I got to middle school, things changed. In the midst of all the craziness of becoming one of the big kids on campus, I started worrying about the little things, like the first zit on my face, or what I was going to wear to school. I started to worry about what others thought. I started to think about those number one fears. I was once a fearless Xena warrior princess, but now I'd become a girl afraid of others because I was severely bullied by my classmates. Because of their actions and words, I felt shut off, alone, and scared of the outside world. I let what they did engrave those number one fears into me to the point of where I no longer wanted to try anything new. Instead of continuing to participate in activities that didn't used to scare me, like speech contests and school musicals, I played it safe and stayed away. When I reached high school, my fears remained and I turned from every opportunity and stuck to what I knew best, softball. When my ag advisor came to me and asked if I wanted to do the creed, I said no, because I told myself, I can't do that. People will judge me and I will fail. To this day, that is still one of my biggest regrets in high school. But you know what isn't? When I finally gave myself the chance to try something new and I joined the parliamentary procedure team, That one decision, as scary as it was in that moment, helped me to become a better person and achieve greater things. It helped me to move past someone who had learned to stay safe and say no to someone who was willing to take a risk and say yes. If I hadn't taken that initial chance and joined that team, I would have never been able to experience all the amazing things I have had these past 4 years. I don't believe I would be standing here right now on this stage, proud to have served as your state reporter this past year. When we face those challenges, it might feel as though we are just facing our fears. But we soon discover that we are actually striving for our dreams, because our dreams lie just on the other side of our fears. So make a decision right now that you are going to start tackling your fears. Your dreams are out there. You can achieve them. So pursue them with everything you have. Just know that dreams come at a price too. The price of facing your fears. The price of becoming that slightly different person, or maybe even that radically different person, as you leave behind the you that couldn't do it to find the you that rocked it. Remember learning to ride your bike? When you gained competency, you gained confidence. But the competency to ride your bike didn't come through waiting or wishing. It only happened when you took action. So take action. Take action to make your dreams a reality. Make a promise to yourself right now that when you leave this convention, you are gonna set new goals for yourself. Goals that are way out there. Goals that scare you to death. Because if your goals, if your dreams aren't big enough to scare you, they aren't big enough to change you. So don't settle. Don't play it safe. Don't let fear define you, like I almost did. I did say no to Creed, and I almost said no to Parley Pro. But when I took that initial chance to try something new, I had no idea what it would ask of me, or where it would even take me. I just knew that the commitment scared me to death, and that's why I did it. I was already beginning to understand that being safe was not the same thing as being happy. So I had to do it. I had to commit. Even though I knew that sometimes I would mess up and fall short of my goal. But along the way, I was changing. I was growing. I was gaining that competency that creates confidence. So, as a team, we pursued our competitive goals. And with every win, it just opened the way to the next one. Winning sectionals meant regionals. Regionals meant state. And then state meant nationals. There we were, in Kentucky, sitting in the banquet hall amongst the other competitors. We were beyond nervous. It seemed as though the night's proceedings had gone on for hours. But when they reached the announcements of the final four, our team held each other's hands, closed our eyes, and bowed our heads, praying that our name would be called as the next national champion parliamentary procedure team. And in fourth place from the state of California, Grass Valley, Nevada Union. What? Immediately, our faces changed from anxiety to utter disappointment as the tears began to swell in our eyes. We were devastated. After 4 years of hard work, how could we have only gotten fourth place? But here's the thing. In that moment, I had forgotten why I'd even started that journey, because the only thing that mattered to me was whether we had won or not. I had forgotten that I'd taken on that challenge in the first place to gain confidence. I had forgotten about the laughs and the memories and how much I had grown as a person throughout the process. I now know that the real reward was getting the opportunity to spend 4 incredible years with a team that I will love and cherish for the rest of my life. Because that's where the real victory lies. It's in how we change. It's in how we grow. It's in the struggles we experience as we're gaining those new skills. It's in the sweat and the tears and the heartbreak and the elation of preparing and practicing and finally competing that shows us what we're capable of and what makes us new people. And that is why it matters so much. In 4 years, no one I meet will care that I was on that team, or even maybe that I served as a state officer. But they will immediately know that I am confident, goal-oriented, determined, accountable, and on task. And it's those traits that will impress them. Not the blue ribbon or the award, because we don't always win, but we will always grow. Every task that has something new of us, every challenge that demands we gain a new skill, leaves us a bigger person, a better person, a slightly different person. And that fear, that final fear of failure, loses its grip on us because we understand that it was never really about the blue ribbon or the plaque or the award. Those things are nice. And I promise you, if you accept enough challenges, you will get your share. But it was always, always about the people we were becoming, the lessons we were learning, and the traits we were developing as we pursued our goals, as we achieved our dreams. Because in the end, our best dreams are about the people we can become and not the wins we can rack up. Never measure yourself by your successes and never define yourself by your failures, because you are neither of those things. You are the person pursuing your goals. Sometimes you fall short, and sometimes you succeed beyond your wildest imagination. But either way, you are a better person for having tried. A year ago, I stood on this stage as your newly elected reporter. And even in that moment of overwhelming joy and relief and excitement, I was already hearing those whispers from those number one fears. And right then, I had two choices to make: to face those fears or run from them. And right then, in that moment, I chose to face those fears. I chose to accept this new challenge that you had given me. I promised myself that I was going to become a better person. I was going to learn and grow and become the person that you elected to serve and represent all of you as your state reporter and make you proud to be a member of California FFA.
Thank you, California FFA, for making this year something that I will always remember and love for the rest of my life, and for allowing me to share it with each and every single one of you. You have made a difference in my life more than I can tell you. To the Mayfield family, thank you for accepting me into your home and welcoming me into your family wholeheartedly. Your love and guidance has been something that I could always rely on, and I know that no matter where life takes me, I will always have a place in your heart. Thank you. Teammates, thank you for constantly seeing the best in me. The five of you have impacted me more than you will ever know, and I love you all so much. I know that no matter where life takes us and no matter how many miles may separate us, we will always be a family. I love you all, and thank you. California FFA, instead of accepting your fears as some sort of absolute truth, start seeing your fears as simply an indication of where you are to get to where you need to be. When fear tells you, you can't do that, make your response, but I can learn. When fear tells you, you aren't like that, make your response, but I can become that. And most importantly, when fear tells you, you might fail, then make your response, maybe I will. or maybe I'll succeed. But either way, the real victory is that I did it.
Once upon a younger year, when all our shadows disappeared, the animals inside came out to play. Went face to face with all our fears, learned our lessons through the tears, made memories we knew would never fade. One day my father, he told me, son, don't let it slip away. He took me in his arms, I heard him say, when you get older, your wild heart will live for younger days. Think of me if ever you're afraid. He said one day you'll leave this world behind, so live a life you will remember. My father told me when I was just a child, these are the nights to never die. My father told me. Shining stars. He said, go venture far beyond the shores. Don't forsake this life of yours. I'll guide you home no matter where you are. One day my father, he told me, son, don't let it slip away. When I was just a kid, I heard him say, when you get older, your wild heart will live for younger days. Think of me if ever you're afraid. He said, one day you'll leave this world behind, so live a life.
Thank you. Lolly, LL, E-Money, Ellen. Well, we'll start off with the fact that you're hilarious, and as is a given. Then for a backstory, we'll pepper in the fact that you love cats. Although your driving directions are questionable, you have always steered us in a direction that will always allow us to have fun. Whether it was your random mustaches or pranks after we came back from a home break, we could always count on you to make light of the situation and make us laugh. Not only did you help create memories with our team, but you also sought to create meaningful experiences with the members of the California FFA. Your love for Netflix is contagious, yet so is your love for life. It is that sheer enjoyment you have for life that keeps our team calm, even in the most stressful of moments. We appreciate how present-minded you are, except when you fall asleep on us. This year, you have been a support system for the California FFA members by relating to them on a personal level and creating strong relationships. Wait, what are the other things about her? You bring such a positive vibe, you have an incredible laugh, and trust us when we say, this year would not have been the same without you. We love you, and thank you for bringing bliss into our family. With love, Deepak, Haley, Sierra, Luis, and Roman. California FFA, for the final time, your 2014-2015 state FFA reporter, Miss Ellen Van Hoy.